like to say one thing before we start with the questions. We did not talk about Dr. Goffman's credentials, which are really important. Anybody who doesn't know who this man is, please look on, well, across from page one, and there's a whole explanation of who he is and what he's done. No, 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 I'm talking about in his pamphlet right here, in this abstract. Yes, yes. And I think it's really important that you know who it is that's telling you these things. This is not coming from me, who has no scientific background.
Not a lot of talent.
We're greatly honored to have you here. I mean, I've been an anti-nuclear activist all my life, and this is one of the foremost speakers on this subject in our whole
That's
country.
Right.
And
yes.
he's here talking to us.
That's right.
And
West
That's right. Yeah. Thank you for coming here.
Yes. Right. Dr. Goffman has been in our documentaries before on anti-nuclear subjects.
So we can take any questions. Egan, would you like to fill in any places that I went over too lightly?
No, I think that because you followed a script, you got everything in. But we'd really like to hear some ideas about how to do this. We're, you know better than we what kind of opposition you run into, and if you start doing this and you find people not wanting to sign or not wanting to do something, our phone number, Francine's phone number, you know how to reach us and give us some feedback about what are the obstacles to doing this. We don't have all the answers other than this is something that deserves doing if you would feel good about doing something that guarantees a health benefit. You reduce the x-ray doses, it's guaranteed you will reduce the number of x-ray induced cases of cancer and coronary heart disease.
Scientific method in the dose response study, when you compare two groups and you find a difference in dose, say for x-ray exposure, and you find a difference in cancer rates, that difference is caused by that dose difference if you set up the study properly. And once you've got that, it's obvious that if you took away the dose, you will cut down on the result of cancer. So anybody says, how do you know it'll work? It's guaranteed to work.
Can you give us some numbers of the doses that you're talking about when you talk about decreasing the dosage?
Yeah, what I would say, we're certainly shooting for cutting the dose in half. For various
procedures.
Well, I could give you some numbers, but those numbers are subject to change and subject to a lot of... We have to just start... See, we haven't got anybody that's given us some good measurements out in the field. And without those measurements, you don't know. We may find out it's easy to cut doses down by a factor of three rather than two. That would be great. I could tell you one thing. A very beautiful study was conducted in the city of Toronto by the medical radiologists in the city of Toronto. They went to Dr. Kenneth Taylor, who is in a very fine physics department in the University of Toronto, and they said, we'd like to have you tell us what we're doing wrong and how we might improve our procedure. Kenneth Taylor did a landmark study with 32 radiologic facilities, and that's all published. I can give you the references. Kenneth Taylor showed that with the cooperation of the radiologists, he gave attention to everything he could think of. How they developed the films, how long they used a developing solution, how big the aperture was that got exposed, a whole host of things. And at the end of the study, the radiologists agreed that they had a reduction in the dose necessary to a third, without any quality reduction in their film. So to say, well, it can't be done.
Oh, and without buying any expensive new equipment.
Yeah, no expensive new equipment in the Taylor study. It's a landmark study where some radiologists could agree. I don't think all radiologists are going to refuse to cooperate, but a nudge from 200,000 people in Marin County would be a nice nudge. Yes.
I was thinking that since almost everybody ends up with dental x-rays, do dental x-rays have a big impact? Because if they do, and most people do get dental x-rays, dentists are pretty available opposed to a radiologist, because I've had gone into a radiologist's office and you never even see the radiologist. The technician, and then he talks to your doctor, but you never see him, so you can't influence
him. There is some good news on the dental front with so-called digital imaging.
Right.
They have been able to cut the doses down. That doesn't mean every place that they've got to do it right, but if done right, the dentist can cut the doses
down. So it would be good to
absolutely
take this to your dentist
good
the next
it'd
time
be very
you go,
important.
And they say, open your mouth, you hand them the paper.
It
yes.
Was, where's the study that correlates the x-rays as a cause of cancer?
In the book, Preventing Breast Cancer, Marty, we have flagged the 30-some studies that show this is true. After the initial discovery by McKenzie of Nova Scotia, that started out, you know, the Atomic Energy Commission had been sponsoring the Atomic Bomb Casualty Commission, and they had nothing to say about cancer aside from some leukemias in the early period after the bombing. And in 1965, Ian McKenzie, a Nova Scotia physician, had a patient who came into his office with a fulminant cancer of the breast. And the skin showed changes as though she had had fairly high radiation doses. That is one feature of high doses of radiation to the skin. And he asked about radiation doses. Well, the upshot was that this lady, who had not known that she had had big doses, was in a program for the management of tuberculosis in the TB sanitarium during the 20s and 30s. And the procedure was this. It was felt that tuberculosis could take a young man or a young woman in their 20s or teens, and if you didn't do the right thing, the cavitation as the destruction of the tuberculous lung had occurred, and the pieces of the lung were not apposed to each other. And as long as those stayed open, the patient went on getting bigger and bigger cavitation and died. Many, many tragic deaths of 20-year-olds, 22-year-olds who were thought to be very well. So they had this idea of putting air into the chest in between the rib cage and the pleural surface of the lung to rest the lung. And a lot of people then came out of those TB sands alive who were going to die otherwise. But what McKenzie was seeing was one of the people who had had hundreds of these fluoroscopic pictures taken with air injections. And so she had a huge dose, by the way. And I was at that time 2 years into the tenureship of an organization of a biomedical division in the Livermore lab, and I remember how people ridiculed McKenzie's study. They said, now we've heard everything. Mm-hmm. Breast cancer caused by medical x-rays. Haw, haw, haw. And somebody said, why don't you, what do you find in the atom bomb study? And they said, atom bomb study? Well, we haven't looked at that. And when they looked, in 2 years, Juan Abel published a total confirmation of McKenzie's study. And there have been, as I said, approximately 30 studies since that time. We'll get you a copy of the Preventing Breast Cancer, and they're all flagged. So, is that correct?
I just want to say, so there's not a misunderstanding, that these women who got this fluoroscopy did not get high doses all at once. They got minimal doses, and it was the cumulative effect that caused this reddening of the skin. It wasn't that they got a blast all at once.
In fact, as Egan says, that's part of the proof that low doses are very effective in causing cancer.
Mm-hmm.
See, people said, well, look, the problem is that repair takes care of everything. There are biological mechanisms for repairing things in the chromosomes and the DNA. Actually, repair does take care of a lot. But what we're facing is that part of the damage that is unrepaired, unrepairable, and not repaired. And for example, a patient such as Mackenzie's patient might get a very small dose with just the fluoroscopy to check whether there was enough air for this treatment. And then they'd have no further fluoroscopy for a week or two. So they had way more than enough time to have repair do all of its work. But these people ended up with a much higher rate of breast cancer, which showed that the accumulated small doses are quite effective. In fact, Arthur Upton, the man I quoted about, previous NCI director, Arthur Upton, has written on that same subject, as have we, on the fact that the demonstration in the women with these TB sands of having the big effect of radiation in producing cancer was there, even though each dose was very small and had all kinds of time for repair to repair. It just didn't repair everything. We've got to be sure that Marty gets a copy of this.
Right. Before you take another question, I'd like to get back to your question, because I don't want people not to have any idea about doses. But what John was trying to say is that because doses aren't measured, we can hardly vouch for what the doses are. In other words, when we talk to some radiologists, or a few radiologists write publicly, but but not in any journals anybody but us reads, and they talk about the doses that they're giving, we can tell you about those doses, but we can't say that they're typical or whatever. But for comparison, if you're getting in a mammogram, they're thinking that the typical dose, the average dose, is about 0.2 of a unit of radiation. You go and somebody says, we want to do a follow-up with a CAT scan of your chest, you're going to get 25 times more of a dose. You're going to get like five whole units instead of a fifth of a unit. So is that the sort of thing
yes,
you were looking
exactly.
for? The other thing,
because I wasn't sure how it was measured.
Yeah. Well, I say unit. There are lots of units they use in this kind of business. And the rad used to be, nice simple word, rad, stands for radiation absorbed dose, but they decided they were going to change it to gray and multiply it by 100 so all the doses would look smaller. But a centigray, that's a hundredth of a gray, is exactly the same as a rad. And a rad is the same as a Röntgen, pretty much. Those are the main terms. But
okay.
What you're most interested in are which procedures give the biggest doses. Fluoroscopy, because it's a continuous X-ray beam, and CAT scans. And so when people say, oh, well, all those things Dr. Goffman was talking about, we don't do that anymore. We've had Susan Love say that. Oh, well, you know, we used to do all kinds of things, but we don't do that anymore. Well, right now, it's very likely, we can't prove it because nobody measures doses, that doses are going up because the expansion of the use of fluoroscopy in, for instance, surgical threading catheters, needle biopsies, these are all X-rays. Fluoroscopy, the beam stays on. Fluoroscopy has expanded enormously in the last 20 years. CAT scans were introduced in the 1970s, and now just about everybody gets a CAT scan in the hospital. It's the most common thing they do. One of the leading health physicists, or medical physicists, from the Mayo Clinic has written, again in a journal that nobody sees. If we hadn't talked with him, even we wouldn't have known that this journal existed. He says that he finds that nobody in medical imaging, much less the referring physicians, have any idea what big doses CAT scans are giving. So, unfortunately, you can't take any comfort from the idea that we don't do some of the crazy things we did before 1970. We're doing other crazy things.
Yes.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Some of the people who came in just see that they get copies of
materials.
Right.
Are you out of the red
point?
Yeah,
there's
one.
Okay, we've got.
Here, you can take.
We've got.
I don't want you to get away with that. I see there's this lady with
one.
Everybody here got a red
and white?
Go ahead.
couple of things. I'm really pleased to have this information. I had a client of mine who ended up having a second bout of breast cancer. And I went with her through her surgery. She was already working with me. I'm an alternative practitioner. And she was already working with me and developed this breast cancer, or second bout of it. And the minute the surgeon came out of the operating room, he said to me, this is a direct result of the radiation that she's had for her prior lumpectomy. Mm-hmm. And this was 2.5 years ago. So it was a major wake-up call to me, as it was to her and other women that I work with. So I have two questions. My sense of all the information you've given me, which is wonderful, I'm feeling a little bit overwhelmed because I feel like I have to educate my clients in some ways, and my friends, family too, and also the oncology people that I go and speak with or go to the appointments with on behalf of my clients. So it's like I don't know where to start. I don't know how to sort of present this and say, look, wait a minute, but I need some more really hard facts, because I don't think some of these doctors even know that this, you know, what this information is and exactly the numbers about it. And that's what I'd like to get.
When did you receive this red and white?
Yeah, it's in here.
Okay, let me say something. Red and white, and then the other specific things came up in Egan's preparation for some of these meetings. They're all essential. Go through that material. Sometimes you'll find some of it's a little bit overwhelming, perhaps. Just pass that over and go on. And come back. But let me just say, there's nothing in this that any intelligent observer can fail to fathom.
Yes.
And second, if you go through it and you're having trouble and you need some more backup, why don't you get together with us?
No, I would love to. And this is what I'm saying. I'm going to go
I'm saying that
as
an invitation to everyone. I'd like to see this group many times. I said, I'd like to see this group many times. The more we work on it, the more we will all understand what the best way is to do this. But don't underestimate your power as an individual.
Well, no, I don't. But, and I also want to have the facts that I walk in and say this is the way it is, and it's not that we're going to go beyond this point, which helps. Okay, thank you.
You had a question.
Well, yeah, what would you say to the people that have already had all the x-rays, you know, that are already facing the increased risk? You know, what advice would you give?
Well, that's producing heart disease, and some of those people were not dying of their breast cancer, they were dying of the heart disease that was induced by the radiation. And some of the techniques of tangential administration of the radiation. That's a big field of its own, but I would like to say I think it's a good idea for people that have had all the radiation to keep looking for everything that could possibly be an additional cofactor and coactor, because there may be a lot more that can still be done in people that have the disease. That takes a lot of work and a lot of thinking. But it's not all discouraging.
But what about all the x-rays, people who have had, I mean, there's nothing you can do about
x-rays. Can't get rid of the x-rays, but we might find some things that are in the mixture of things that are considered, that if you reduce them, they will. You may undo some of the effects of the x-rays. For example, cancer of the lung, anyone who doubts cancer of the lung being caused by radiation is just wrong. You can read the chapters in our book on radiation. And anyone who doubts that cancer of the lung is caused by cigarette smoking is wrong if they doubt that. But we do know the evidence indicates that if you go out far enough having stopped smoking, the mortality rate starts to decline. So there are ways that the x-ray or the smoking effects seem to be controvertible.
I just want to make sure that something's clear about when you say maybe undo some of the effect of the radiation. You didn't mean that the mutation that the radiation induces can be undone, but he's talking about this coaction. In other words, if it takes a lot of things to cause a case, if you remove one of them, you can't remove the x-rays you've already had, though you ought to be think hard about having any more, with more mutations chances. But if you remove some of those coactors that were contributing, necessary contributors, let's say to the first cancer or to the future cancer, you can make the effect of the x-rays mutation that's still there less likely to become a cancer. there are a lot of ways that can happen, but I mean, one example is that if you've got a mutation, but it needs a promoter to go with it, you've probably heard of the model of initiator-promoter.
Right, that's really important for people to understand.
Well, the initiator is generally considered to be the mutation.
Right.
Now, X-rays are a champion mutagen, proven, uniquely potent. There are other mutagens, and obviously there was cancer before the X-ray was discovered, but X-rays are a champion mutagen. But the evidence is that these mutagens don't work alone. Mm-hmm. Women or anybody else who inherits, for instance, a breast cancer gene in every cell of her mammary ducts does not get cancer in every cell of her mammary ducts. There's proof right there that the mutation alone doesn't suffice. It needs the other promoters or possibly additional mutations. A lot of cancer special biologists think that 5, 6, 7 mutations have to accumulate. So you can avoid these other things and it will diminish the chance that the X-ray mutations you have already gotten are going to meet their promoter. Follow me?
Yeah. Yes. But do you think you should avoid mammograms if you already had a lot of X-rays?
Yes.
You want to say something, John?
I think that the biggest thing about mammograms, if you've had a lot of X-rays, is you're darn lucky that you're living in the 1990s to the year 2000, because mammograms in the 1970s were a very serious problem. The dose was very high. The mammogram doses are way down now. There are lots of things that come into mammography that are beyond the issue of the radiation dose itself, false positives and false negatives, and it's not the easiest thing in the world to produce a blanket recommendation. But I am happy to see that the mammographers have done such a good job. And I want to say something for those doctors who say, "Well, I don't think you can reduce the dose any lower than it already is." How come Ken Taylor's study worked out so beautifully in the 32 radiology offices? The doses came down. And then you can turn to this person who tells you, "I don't think there's anything you can reduce anymore." When the enthusiasts for mammography in the 70s were called on the carpet, "Hey, look, you may be producing more breast cancer than you're going to detect and cure," they practically turned mammography off. But the mammography people were so interested in going ahead, they were able to go ahead and kick that dose down by a factor of 10 or 20. So for somebody to tell you, "Oh, we know that if this can't be done," the evidence is quite otherwise. Yes.
So I'm going in next week for a mammogram. Now, should I struggle with them about cutting my dose down?
I always struggle with them.
And am I going to say yes if I...
Well, you know, get it an address and get some copies of this red and white and take it into them. So you all
I'll take it with me. Well, yeah.
Yeah, leave it with them. I'll get you another one.
Oh, okay. Great.
What's a good dosage to rely on for a mammogram?
It's about 2/10 of a rad.
Well, that's the average. What they don't tell women is that it depends a lot on the size of your breast.
Uh-huh.
Big-breasted women have to have more of a dose because these X-ray photons, in order to expose the film on the other side, have to get through more tissue.
Uh-huh.
So when we say 0.2 of a rad or a centigray or a Roentgen, these dose units, that's just the average. But some will be higher, some will be lower, and the risk that's in this little sheet we gave you inside the red and white, the staple thing, is again based on averages. For some women, the risk is going to be lower, but on other women, the risk is going to be a lot higher. They're going to get a higher dose, and maybe they're one of the unlucky ones who's got a bad repair system for the genetic damage, and it's just not possible to identify such women now, although the AT gene, the ataxia
telangiectasia.
Thank you. Gene is supposed to be in what percentage of women? 2% or 4%?
I don't know.
And it's supposed to make you particularly sensitive to radiation damage. And but people don't, nobody knows who's got it. So they're looking for alternatives to mammography, as probably all of you know, and heat, infrared, is one of the things that some women swear by. Dr. Goffman, I think correctly, is not an expert in that, so he's not going to speak on whether he, you know, thinks that that's an adequate substitute for mammography. That's one thing he's taught me, is don't talk about something you don't know about. It's better to say, I don't know, and we don't know about just how good this thermography is. It's claimed that it's used all over Europe, and that, you know, they're very happy with it. But since we don't know, we're not going to say that's the thing to do.
Where is it used here?
San Rafael.
Really?
Yeah.
A San Rafael a mammography center?
Yes.
Thermography.
Yeah.
No X-ray radiation.
So then that would be harmless from the standpoint of...
Yeah. Infrared doesn't give radiation?
No, infrared is definitely not the same.
Well, it's not the same, but is it not a...
Infrared is radiation, but if you're talking about breaking bonds and creating chromosome abnormalities, you can't do it with the energy in infrared.
Oh, really?
Now, I'm not sure if you heated your body up to 500 degrees, you wouldn't be alive, but you might have done something.
A lot of heat kills them.
You know, I really hope that you think about this business of what one county can do to get things going. I think I hope all of you will leave a signed copy of the patient's right to know policy statement. I hope you'll take some of those home with you for your friends. But we ought to be able to get 5 million signatures, provided we just stepwise move out to other counties, to the state of California, then some other places. And we have some people that are trying to do this other than in California, but I think power is in one place being focused on.
I got a call from a man in Boise, Idaho, who got your information. And this man's wife died of breast cancer 3 years ago.
Reed Burkholder.
Yes, he has read everything. I mean, he is so knowledgeable. He said he hasn't found one person who he could talk to in Boise, Idaho. It's just nobody wants to even think about what is causing cancer. So what I suggested is that he call Nancy Evans, which he did, and get a copy of Rachel's Daughters and show it at his church and to his friends. And he's done it already. I mean, he's called her. This is a guy who's really determined to do something.
Reed Burkholder is a dynamo.
He is.
And you know, that's an answer to what someone was sitting back there. That's one person.
That's right.
And
he can change the whole course of what's happening.
Well, Reed Burkholder called us because he turns out that he is the man who wants to tear down the dams to save the salmon on the Idaho River. And he is you've probably all heard about this, right?
Oh.
Well, he started it all by himself when nobody was listening. And he can do things. And so he was teasing us. He said, what, just the two of you are going to, you know, turn this whole thing around? And we said, no, we need help. And you know, he knew that he by himself didn't do it, but he managed to inspire the help, and we're hoping for help from you all, because it isn't, once you have the petitions or the policy statements, you've got to do something with them, and what to do with them is, for instance, that the medical community this should not be an anti-medical community thing. Yeah. They should be invited to be participants. Right. If they're hostile, so what? You haven't hidden it from them. What do you think about this policy statement? And blah, 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 blah. And you listen. And you know, we're also willing to go with you on these early meetings so that you don't feel, you know, stranded or whatever. But we all need to listen as to how could anybody object to such a reasonable proposal, and then take that into account. Because if the radiologists would in fact decide that, it is important to start finding out what our doses are, and, you know, took the lead, all the other people who give x-rays, besides radiologists, the dentists, the chiropractors, the urologists, the cardiologists, the bone people, orthopedists, Lots and lots of people give x-rays besides radiologists, but it's so tantalizing to think that if 25 radiologists in Marin County would get behind this overnight, they could make all the difference.
Like
they
20 would. People in this room.
Yeah. Right. I'm saying
well, we're not all radiologists.
If the radiologist would take a position
well,
and say...
Well, you've got one person per radiologist.
Right. So it's doable. But there's, you know...
You've got 20 people tonight. Everybody's going to filter out and nothing's going to happen.
And we want it to
happen. How can we change
you
that?
You sign up for... You got a phone book with radiologists that's here? Yeah, there's a phone book right next door, for heaven's sakes. You know, they're listed in the phone book. We can sign up, come back next weekend. Otherwise, it just goes off, you talk about it, and nothing gets done. There's a phone book.
So you want us to go to a radiologist?
Or yeah.
Let's
pick one.
Easy. Uh-huh.
If every radiologist and every physician in Marin County, for instance, got a copy of the red and white, that would certainly start a buzz. They could no longer be ignorant. Now, they may say, oh, well, this isn't peer-reviewed. Well, you know, Dr. Goffman's talked about the meaningless of peer review. They didn't disregard the Surgeon General's report because it wasn't in a journal. But you have at least cracked open their mind to this information is available. They don't see the information, even the peer-reviewed stuff, this, you know, this brand-new study. Nobody's seen that. You can call it to their attention. And
this stuff doesn't get sent out to the radiologists, all this stuff you're giving us?
We'd like you to
take
it. But we have sent it to, for instance, some of the leading radiologists in the country. And there's a whole committee of the National Academy of Sciences, which is now looking into, again, low-dose radiation. They do this periodically. We've taken the stuff right to them. You know, we've taken it to the lion's den, and that includes radiologists. And
You mentioned today, and that's relevant to what this lady has said, that we could, if it were felt that people would work on it, we could get it to all the physicians in Marin County.
Well, absolutely.
Red and white, I mean.
Yeah, we're willing to, you know, to donate this and see that it gets done, but, you know, the two of us can't do it by ourselves. We need your help.
Yes.
And
why don't we just mail them? Or do you think it's better to go in person?
Oh, of course it's better to go in person. If you mail them, it's just going to get lost, like everything gets lost on my desk.
But it is more than just information, too. It's radiologists, gynecologists, and so they have an attitude about it.
Yeah.
I know when it came out in the Independent Journal that the incidence of breast cancer in Marin County was higher than any place else in the United States, I saw my gynecologist like 2 days after that, and I said, well, what do you think about this? And then his response was he went into the statistics of it and said, it's such a small percentage of increase in cancer that it's really not that meaningful. And that has to be an attitude on his part that women are getting overly excited about this issue.
Well, we were called hysterical by Dean Adell.
By Dean Adell.
Yes, he said we were hysterical women.
Dr. Dean.
Well, that's why, though, there's strength in numbers. You're absolutely right that some doctors have a real attitude, and many, you know, for this issue, the worst attitude is that it's not a problem. We're not doing any harm. Doses are already low as they possibly can be. It's misinformation that's their attitude, and they don't see the information, whether it is or isn't in a journal. They don't see it. I think the strength in numbers is how to cope with this, you know, hysterical ladies. When you have 500 or the first 1,000 signatures, and you take it to the IJ, or you take it to the Board of Supervisors, or you take it to the CEO of Marin General, and you say, you know, we'd like an appointment. Well, you know, you represent somebody. It isn't you acting singly. So I think the single action and the cooperation with the Marin Breast Cancer Group, I'd like to say, because I know you feel this very strongly too, and that is if Francine Levien hadn't recognized the moral and health importance of this issue, we wouldn't be here and this wouldn't be a possible project in Marin. It took Francine to recognize it, and She really deserves your gratitude.
And KPFA, I believe I heard you on KPFA about 2 weeks ago.
Yeah.
I don't, that,
was it? Yeah. But I was very impressed, and so I was glad to be able to come today.
Well, I have an idea that we need to go to the farmer's market. And you know where they have the ironing board set up as you come in with all the petitions and everything? I think we need, this needs to be a petition there.
Dr. Goffman and Francine, I want to thank you both for being pioneers in focusing the American Cancer Society on the causes of cancer as opposed to just the cure of cancer. I see this in the next 10 years, this is just a major trend that will be happening. And I really thank you for being a pioneer here, both of you, because I just came from a meeting from the Healthy Schools Initiative that just got passed, and you know it's very good news that now everybody, every parent will know what pesticides will be used in the schools and when they sign up to use the school. And for the first time, the American Cancer Society actually supported this measure. And it's a great time for this breakthrough, and so let's just keep pushing for it because it certainly is long overdue.
Long overdue. Thank you so much.
We thank you for what you've been doing on that issue.
You're welcome.
I just have a quick question on the role of chiropractors. You briefly mentioned chiropractors along with dentists. Is there any kind of formal training that needs to be done before these chiropractors use these machines? I recently went in for a chiropractic adjustment, and before she even did anything to me, she took a number of x-rays. And she was claiming the whole time that, oh, they were much lower than most x-ray machines, and I'm wondering if you can speak at all about that.
You have a couple of essays on that.
Usually a good chiropractor does not take x-rays unless it's absolutely necessary.
There's a big split in the chiropractic profession.
Yeah.
Many of them won't have anything to do with x-rays anymore, even though it was a popular practice.
And she was saying it was a brand new machine, and
well,
that has very low doses.
Part of that may be true in that case, but I doubt that she knew that.
One of the things which Francine's group may be able to help you all organize and so forth, there's some fact-finding here in Marin County. For instance, exactly what are the rules in California for operating an x-ray machine, and how often are they inspected, and when they inspect the machines, do they ever actually do a reality check on what doses are being given? Because survey after survey has shown that the assumed doses and the actual doses can differ by fourfold, tenfold. And so when you ask your dose and they've never measured your dose, then they run to the back room and they look up some chart of if our machine was set this and this and this way, the dose for a patient of not your size, just a standard size, should have gotten a dose of such and such. That doesn't tell you anything that has to do with your dose, if you're thick or thin or not the size of that phantom, or if their machine was not calibrated right so that the assumed dose is 4 to 10-fold different from what their chart says. You've got useless information. There is no substitute for some reality check. So when you're doing your fact-finding, you find out whether these inspectors, which may come around once every 3 years or so, actually ever measure any doses. That's not necessarily required, and we just haven't had time to find out all these things, but these are the sorts of things that you could be finding out.
So if you look on a bottle of aspirin, it says that this is what the dose should be, and almost any prescription medication carries on it a fairly straightforward, easily readable dose, and there's nothing like that in radiation at all. There's no standardized established doses for radiation procedures or x-ray procedures.
Is that true? There is a standardized dose. Of course, there are different doses for people of different fitness and so forth. But they may say that there are standards, and they may say that they're operating a certain way, but where's the evidence? There are no doses that are written down anywhere. There are no doses that are measured, or very rarely measured. So we can say, for all practical purposes, nothing's being done.
And the adjunct to that is that nobody has ever tested current radiation, current X-ray equipment to determine what is the minimum amount of dose that will effectively do a mammogram, effectively take a picture of my upper dentures, effectively do any of that. Nobody's ever determined that either. Is that correct?
Well, I think they try.
Yeah.
But they don't keep records of it. That's just precisely what we're asking is, let's have those records kept, because then we'll get to know whether we're going up in dose. You know, there's a big movement now for what's called a new way of preventing disease. Has nothing whatever to do with prevention. It's what some people call secondary prevention. That's to take a whole body scan with a CAT scan.
What?
Yeah. Whole body scan and say, gee, we'll look, maybe there's a cancer
maybe
here.
We'll find something.
We
that
may
we can
find
treat
something.
And
besides which, if we don't find if we don't find anything, come back in 3 months. Right. We may have it down. This is very serious business. It is being highly promoted.
It was a big feature this morning on Good Morning America. With them slobbering over the idea that we can all have full body CAT scans and
over and over.
Yes.
And what did you say it's called? Second
CAT.
Whole body CAT scan.
Whole body CAT scan.
Did you say secondary prevention or something?
Oh, yeah.
And what will it do for us?
Well, it'll show up if you have anything wrong.
Oh, yeah.
If you have one little stray cancer cell someplace, you can be treated for it.
Well, your question was?
What you secondary? Mentioned something about secondary prevention.
Well, you know, the fact is mammography is not a prevention.
Right.
CAT scans are not a prevention. Whole body CAT scans are not a prevention. But they like to say, if we get the diagnostic imaging done early in the course of the disease, it's as good as prevention, or we might call it secondary prevention. But it's not prevention in any way. And I just sort of shudder to think of the people, like one person you told me about on today's program, and I didn't hear it, said, I can afford it. I'll have these done every 3 months. They'll be sick.
But I know I asked you this last time about the correlation between people that are well off and who have lots of insurance who can do all these and people who can't do these tests. I mean, isn't that why we're finding more breast cancer in wealthy areas?
I would think that people that use their wealth to have more procedures are almost certain to have. I don't know what's going to protect them.
It seems that way.
It's a horrible thing to be expecting to get some kind of a cancer instead of expecting to be healthy and well. Test me all the time because I'm expecting to have some kind of sickness.
They call it the worried well.
Yes.
This is an exam for the worried well. It's only $1,000.
Did we do anything with your suggestion about the radiologist?
At the phone book. In the physicians and surgeons index, it doesn't separate radiologists, and it's only labs.
That's right.
The back. So
they don't list their names, do they?
And since mostly technicians or assistants give these at the dental, who's trained? What's the training? Is there a school of radiology at the University of Berkeley? And does everybody have to go to that before they push the button?
The chiropractors don't.
Who does that? Who does
through their school. They have to be certified.
We can find those things out. I don't know all the details of their regulatory apparatus, except that it doesn't function very well. I know that when we were checking some of this out earlier, we found that the examinations of the instrumentation, which is supposed to be on a regular schedule, was sometimes not done more than once in 7 years instead of once.
The state doesn't do that? Like
the state has that function.
But they do it with weights and measures once a year, quite regularly, so they don't do that with regularity.
the scales in a butcher shop are better regulated than radiation equipment.
Yeah, that sounds right. That sounds right.
Well, we're hoping that that's one of the fact-finding things that you will do, is you will talk to, for instance, how many hospitals are there in Marin? Is it just the one, or?
Oh, no. There's Kaiser, there's Nevada.
Another one, Nevada.
Well, right. You see, as a group, you've got status. You've got standing to go in, and you say, how often do you have your machinery checked? What are, you know, are all your rad techs certified or your dental techs certified? And most important, one of the suggestions, and this is all in the handouts we've given you, is on, because fluoroscopy is a source of high doses, that's when the beam is continuous. I think you really want to know in every fluoroscopy machine in every hospital, at least, and leave the private ones till later, in the hospitals, that the machine has a limit, a dose limit set on it of the rate per minute. That didn't become a regulation until 1965, was it, or 75? 95, I think. 95. That these machines could give any dose rate per minute, and of course with the lack of attention to dose, you know, horrendous doses were given. The FDA set a regulation nationally for the new equipment built after 1995 shouldn't be allowed to go over a certain dose rate. However, you don't have to buy the new equipment. Any old machine can be set with a limit. You need to know whether these machines have a limit of dose and what it is, who's allowed to use the machinery. You read in these handouts what the Mayo Clinic man said, and that is that totally untrained people are being allowed to use fluoroscopes in hospitals. He says simply, you should ask this, you know, demand whatever, you should talk to the hospitals about requiring that they credential people before they're allowed to use their fluoroscopy machines, so that they have, you know, training and know. The Mayo Clinic guy says that they don't have, many users of fluoroscopy in hospitals don't have the fundamental knowledge about radiation safety or radiation anything.
He said that in the 1998 publication.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, we're going to change it.
Right?
And we're going to change it.
Yay!
Yes.
Yay.
Yeah.
The best
okay, well, everybody hand them their petition if you want to.
I just recently searched Marin County for a dentist that had the digital, you know, reduced radiation machine, and I found one in San Anselmo.
Near me?
Yes, right
yes.
by you.
That's
yeah.
what I heard.
Right by you. Yeah, I told you that. Yeah.
Are you the one who told me that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. His name is Dr. Sarman, S-A-A-R-M-A-N, and I also, it's supposed to be 10% of the normal amount of radiation.
By the way, I just want to say those claims are correct. We hear those claims too, 10%, 20%, 30% of the other kind, the film type of dose. We can't verify that. We can't vouch for it. Nobody's measuring it. It is so simple to measure an X-ray dose, and this is also described in your handout. And in fact, we brought a sample of this little tiny thing that gets pasted on your skin. It doesn't interfere with the X-ray image at all. This is just how simple it is. It's called a little TLD, and it's about the size of your thumbnail here, and it's sticky on one side, and they put it here, or they put it here, or they put it, you know, wherever. It measures the dose.
Oh, really?
Not instantaneously. They have to put it into a machine that reads it.
Really?
And it costs about $8 when something like this is done in any quantity. You know, this is not an expensive piece of information. The reason they don't do it is because of this false assumption nurtured by the government that it doesn't matter, that low doses don't matter. And that's not because it's only Dr. Goffman who has the proof that they do, but because they don't see the, you know, the other proof that's buried in these journals they don't see.
Yes,
can you sell those things or give them to women like me? I get x-rays twice a year because I've had cancer, so... and can I get something like that and take it with me?
You want to talk about
it? Get their attention. Yeah.
We wish that you could. This may be a project that ultimately is part of the making Marin County a demonstration project, where the women actually either insist that this is done.
So the doctor, the hospital should have this.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Why
exactly.
Can't I get one?
Well, let me...
because they need the machine to read it, right?
The machine to read it is about, we've heard estimates like $10,000, but yes. All you need is one in one city or one county. Often this is done by mail. They're just sent in. The companies that make these are making them right now for occupational exposure, nuclear workers and some, you know, people get occupationally exposed. They're not made yet for medical x-rays because, as we've said to 1,000 times, nobody's interested at the
most
moment.
Most companies want more customers.
In measuring.
They'll probably sell them to anybody who write a check.
Yeah, but you need the machine.
The story,
you can mail them.
The story of this is very interesting and sad, and you suggested I tell them. In 1985, two radiologists started this company. It was called Compuran. This radiologist was young. He had a newborn child who had many congenital defects and was getting x-rayed like crazy, you know, right out of the birth canal. And this radiologist was worried, you know, what kind of doses are you giving my infant? And he was just appalled that he had no way to know. And he got this idea we ought to have a simple way to measure doses. And so he, poor thing, he, you know, set up a company. He borrowed $2 million of money from his friends, you know, and he tested the whole thing. He did a study with the Blue Cross. This was back in New York State, and they found that this worked just fine. You know, they tested out to make sure it was calibrated and gave reliable doses, and the whole system worked. And the whole thing was ready to go. And I'm not saying that this is the way it is today, but this was 15 years ago. At that point, the head of the powers that be in his professional society just killed it. They just put the kibosh on it. They said this will scare patients.
Oh, well, that's always the
we don't want, you know, patients to worry or even think about their doses. This is just the worst thing that could ever happen. And the whole thing was crushed, and he ended up, you know, with his $2 million debt, feeling he'd betrayed everybody. And, you know, when we call him, he still, you know, is very friendly, but he's not doing anything about this anymore. I think
so
it just ruined his life.
This is
not available. However, the technology is, you know, simple. It's done for nuclear workers all the time. It could be done for measuring x-ray doses. It was proven.
Well, what does he need to continue his...
He needs heart, I guess. I don't know.
More funding? More interest?
Well, more interest, yes. I mean, you know, if there was this county that was, or Bay Area, that was just roaring to go, I think
where
that it wouldn't be hard. Well, he's a radiologist in New York State.
Egan, did you
yes.
bring extra petitions with you if people
yes,
want
yes.
to take
yes, there's a staff
some
back there
okay.
on the table.
So take, you know, if you want to take some for
yes,
your
please
out
do.
To friends.
Can we find out the name of the company that makes those?
But they're out of business.
Oh, they're out of
they're
business.
They're bankrupt.
Yeah. Nobody makes them anymore.
But there are lots of people who make these, what they're called, the TLDs. It's just they make them for occupational exposures, which is not the same kilovoltage and so forth as medical x-rays. It would have to be like these, made for medical x-rays.
That's
Teledyne makes them.
I don't think that's a big riddle. They did it. Starting at scratch, and it can be done. It's just a matter of wanting it. I'd say a little further along in Marin County, I think you ought to have.
There's a .com for you.
Yeah.
Come on.
Anyway, may I suggest that when people find like a digital radiologist and so forth, can you put that up on your website?
Yeah, I will.
I don't know if you can start building a database of things like that, useful information.
Sure.
And also the thermography, the infrared mammography, things like that.
Just look under the white pages under thermography.
Yeah, it's just
yeah.
You told them about
I mean, it's just
that.
Listed under pH. Yeah.
The fact that
yeah.
the
talk
is available.
Oh, right.
There's one
that's
important.
That's it.
Well, you tell them.
That's it. Lockwood.
Where are they?
Yeah,
they're in the back
place.
Of the room.
What do they do?
But they do
thermography.
They do colonics and thermography?
Well, she started doing
yeah.
that.
Where is it?
In San
I'm
Rafael.
Not sure. It's called Lacrimi.
I would like to say one more thing about the... Well, since I adhered to following the things I had printed out, I thought you'd like to probably have a copy of it. So you can have a copy of everything I said, but only with some corrections of some of the English where I missed the comma. But they're here for you to have a copy of everything we've talked about tonight.
Thanks.
Thanks for
your
generosity.
That was so thermography.
Yes, right there.
I think it's D6.